I teach children from 6 to 66 and up. I don't care. I have no barriers. You don't have to be Miss High Polloi Dressage Queen. In fact, I give the dressage queens a hard time because they won't laugh and they won't talk to their horse. And I'm like, you know what? Drink a half bottle of wine before you go in the ring, no? Might help you out, right? I don't need the half bottle of wine because I already got it going. Like, this is how you ride. It's got to be a figure of eight. So I'll teach you to have that suppleness in your hips, because without that, you're going to have a problem sit the horse. You need to be able to follow with no restriction. Then you can learn how to use it. You have to control it first, know what it's doing, then you can tell it to do something. Otherwise, the horse is going, what? What was that? Am I supposed to listen to that? Oh, well, I didn't really know if that was an aid or not. So they're confused, right? And then we get after them because they're confused. Well, your body is doing a whole lot of something that they doesn't know that it's doing. So the way that I teach is to get people to be aware of their body, what they're doing. And then you learn to use it, control it, refine it, then you become a rider. A little bit about me. I have been riding since I was 10 and I turned 56 this year, so a long time. I've been riding a lot of thoroughbreds off the track. I retrained all the crazy horses that nobody could handle. Had a riding school in Jamaica for 6 years with 35 horses. And in 1990, I was fortunate enough to shortlist for the Pan Am Games in dressage. It involved taking my horse off the island, which is very, very difficult to do when you own an animal that is used to tropical diseases, because they have natural antibodies in their blood for things like tick fever. And if you export the horse, and you could start an epidemic basically. And that year, the Pan Ams were being held in Minneapolis, St. Paul, in the States. So the other girls that were going were all part of a 3-day eventing team. And I was the only dressage rider. And one of the girls almost lost her horse because you had to give them these injections to kill the antibodies in their blood. And she damn near lost her horse. And I decided, you know what? I'm not doing this to my animal, because why would I lose a good horse? I would never forgive myself. So I'm going to tell you the story of when my life changed. When I was thinking about how I would work with horses in my life. I was in my early 20s. My father had recently died. I was 23 years old and he just died. And I was devastated because my dad and I were extremely close. Anyway, I was given a secretariat's son. Ball of fire, red man with attitude, talent, brains, and everything plus again. So I had this red horse. He had had a sesamoid fracture in his left foot and he had been taken off of racing. Yes, so he had spent like 9 months in a stall. And as you can imagine, after that amount of confinement with a thoroughbred, with that kind of bloodlines, he was absolutely bonkers. He threw every rider that tried to ride him. They tried to play polo. He flung all the polo people as well. And basically, they didn't know what to do with him. So they figured that they should give him to Anne, because nobody else was dumb enough, or so they thought, to do anything with this horse. So I get this horse, and I am going through a very stressful time in my life. At the same time as I had this horse on the farm, and I was having so much trouble, there was an old cattleman called Mally, who was as black as your hat, and the sweetest, quietest person you have ever met. Most of the time he was drunk. Anyway, Mally used to ride the Red Fury, as we named him, for me. And I would watch with disgust, I can tell you, as this old man, half drunk, would ride my crazy red horse on a long rein with absolutely no problem whatsoever. It drove me insane. I'm like, what the hell am I doing? What is going on? Like, how come he has no problems with this horse? And I feel like I'm gonna die every time I ride him. One night, I was over by the stables and I saw Malcolm coming home through the pastures, through the dairy cows. Now, if the horse had wanted to take off with him, he could have very easily, right? And he was asleep riding my horse, okay? And he came home and stood outside. The horse brought him home, stood outside the barn, and eventually he woke up and got off the horse. And I was so confused by this. I'm like, oh my God, I don't get this. I don't know what I'm doing wrong. Anyway, the next thing that happened was a man who I believe is from Argentina, but I'm not sure. I know that it was some South American country. Good boy. Named Major Hector Carmona. He's dead now. He was the first man to take a pure Arab to Olympic level. And he came to Jamaica because we don't have coaches and trainers, so we import them. He came to Jamaica to do a clinic, and he was going to be working out of a place near to me. So I signed up, and of course, the minute that everyone heard that I was gonna be there with this crazy lunatic animal, we had all kinds of people showing up to watch the show because they all convinced that Hector Carmona was going to die, being as how he was like in his 70s or whatever. Anyway, good. That's it. Good boy. Yes. There you go. So we're doing a little suppling haunches in. Doesn't have to be huge. Just a little bit. It's a tractor parked in the corner. All right? You don't have to worry. It's not going to eat you. Anyway, so of course my turn comes and Major Hector Carmona comes to me and says, what are the issues you're having with this horse? And I explained, he knew he was only three turning fours, a young horse. Anyway, so that's fine. So he gets on and of course all of us are like, oh my God, he's gonna die. Well, I have to tell you, within 15 minutes, he had my horse not only walk, trot, canter, he had passage, piaf, flying changes, and extensions. My jaw was down to my knees because I didn't think this was possible. And I never saw anything move. He rode without spurs, he rode without anything, just a snaffle bit. And my horse was doing all this stuff, and all of us were in total shock. So that day, he got off, and he handed me the reins, and he said, if a horse can feel the legs of a fly, what are we doing?